you tell, I mean, I don't know if you were reading the notes already, because a lot of what you said is actually in your notes. So if you look at, we start from the first one, be punctual and present, okay? These are roles and responsibilities, what a tutor should be doing. The first thing is a tutor should always be punctual. There before your students, set up the classroom, be present, as in not only physical presence, but when your students are talking to you, be present with your students and engaging to your students. Always be prepared, okay? Don't go into the class and ask them, what should we do today? Or what did you do in class? So what would you like to do? Because immediately they look at you and they think, this person doesn't know what they want, okay? So be prepared. Always go prepared, but then you don't have to stick to your script and say, no, 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 I can't discuss that because this is what I'm supposed to be doing today. Be flexible, okay? Be professional at all times. Although I told you that you guys are not the lecturer, but neither are you the tutee, you the tutor. So you need to be professional, you need to set ground rules. I don't need to tell you guys, all of you are teachers, you know when you see a class for the first time, you set ground rules. But it's not my ground rules when I walk in and say, these are my rules, you will do this, do this, do this. You go and you ask him, okay, let's set some rules. What do you think should be the ground rules for this tutorial? And it's amazing how they come up with the rules. We must be punctual, we mustn't be on our cell phone, we mustn't be doing this. And then you write that down and say, that's great, so let's use this as our ground rules. So you didn't decide, it came from your class, and it becomes more respectful because you included them in the decision making. Be confident and approachable. Know your stuff. Don't go there and say, oh gosh, I don't know what this is. You can say that now and then, but most of the time you have to be confident. Even if you don't know it, be confident and say, I don't know, but I'm going to find out for you. Or can anybody else in this class help us out? So they can see that you are just like it. Okay? What is that one now? That one is? Encouraging. Encourage independent learning. That's the most important thing, because our students will become dependent on you. As soon as you want to help them with certain things, they say, can you do this assignment? I'm stuck with this. You have to be asking all the questions and developing their thinking so finally they get the answer. You shouldn't tell them. You should be leading them to find the answer. So you're developing independent thinking and learning. Okay. The next one is keep accurate records. That is very, very important for you. And I think then Ruben is going to ask for this. And Ruben is a hectic guy because everything Ruben does by the book, he has all neat records. You go into his office is neat, all his books are in a pile, he even scares me. So record keeping is important. When you go to the tutorial class, make sure the register goes up. Everybody signs the register, you collect the register, you keep it with you. When you have one-on-one sessions with the students, immediately, many of you have been to the doctor's office. You would see the doctor would, as soon as you come in, open the file and say, okay, your last visit, you were here a few weeks ago, you had a headache, how is it now, is it gone, whatever. So when your tutor comes in to you, before they come in, just take out their file, check last, what did they come to you for, whatever. So when they come in, you go back, ask them, and then you look at the new issue. But always they need to sign in. So then Ruben can look at that, and then when your claim forms come in, you could actually see, okay, this work was done. Okay. So your record keeping is very, very important. Have regular meetings with your lecturers. You should be having weekly meetings with your lecturers, but some lecturers actually meet every second week. But you should be meeting with your lecturer. It shouldn't be you taking over, you doing whatever, the lecturer does his own thing. The lecturer is supposed to be guiding you and helping you. So that's an important one, that's your role. Attend formal lectures. I think that's a requirement. Once a week, whichever lecture you are giving tutorials in, you need to be attending one of the formal lecturer. A lecturer sitting in and seeing what happens. So when a question comes up in class, then you can say, you can give them the correct answer because you were there in that lecture. And all these things you get paid for, by the way, so. regular and constructive feedback. When you give feedback to them, it should be regular. When you give them a task, you shouldn't take 10 or 15 days to complete that task. It should be ready for the next week, and you should be able to give them feedback. And the type of feedback you give them should be constructive feedback, and we're going to come to that section next about indirect feedback. I'll explain that when we're looking at your tutorial sessions. And then the most important thing, which all of you picked on earlier, so I think it's a good thing to know your students and their capabilities. I think all of you are teachers, so you have that experience. You don't go into a class and teach to the class. You teach to the individuals in the class. So you don't go into your lesson and say, this is my lesson, I'm expecting all of them to know exactly what I'm talking about. Some of them may not know. So you're teaching individuals in a classroom. Okay? Roles and responsibilities. What? Okay. Etiquette, if you're going to cancel a lecture, you need to inform your students firstly. Hopefully you have WhatsApp groups to them. And now that we had the Ikamba training this morning, you're going to make groups on the Ikamba or whatever that site is. And so you can inform them immediately. I think WhatsApp students check WhatsApp. So you can tell them, sorry, I won't be in tomorrow, or I'm going to be late for this session. But keep them informed. They respect you because you're respecting them. Okay? Rescheduling, and the most important thing is to tell the tutor coordinator beforehand, I won't be making this lecture, so he can actually help you out and maybe go and paste it on the wall, on the door outside to say, lecture has been cancelled or rescheduled or whatever. So when you cancel, always reschedule so your tutor coordinator and your lecturer know about it. So when you're claiming as well, that would go on your claim forms. Okay? Ethical behavior, sometimes your students may come and tell you something that's quite private. You don't share it with the rest of the class or your buddies, okay? You should have some ethical behavior with your students. Also, I think if it's something very serious, then you refer them to the student service or you go and tell the tutor coordinator, this is my experience with the student, how do you think we should take it forward? Also with the student, you should ask permission, can I discuss this with the tutor coordinator and maybe they can help you with it. Because sometimes they don't like to go to the lecture because most of the time they're complaining about their lecturers. So please don't add to that when they say, oh, this lecturer is like this, and you say, yeah, that lecturer really is that way, and don't add to the conversation, okay? Just listen, and then if you want, take it to the tutor coordinator because it can be quite sensitive. Evaluation and review, this would be done. You can do evaluation of your own teaching with your students, come up with your own evaluation and review yourself. But what would happen formally would be the tutor coordinator with the lecturer would have evaluation of your tutorials. They would send out evaluation forms to students once a semester and students would respond. It could be online evaluation. Or it could be where they will come into your class and take over a few minutes of that time with your students to fill it in without you guys being there. So that will come back to you, your tutor coordinator will review that and then tell you about your performance and what needs to be changed or what the issues are. Okay? Class size, they shouldn't be filling enough claim forms. Do that on time. Because then you can't go fight with Ruben and say, Ruben, this form, I couldn't make it, the bus broke down, whatever. It's not him. It's work study. And if you're one day late, they don't even care. Which is quite sad. Because then you don't get paid for the whole month and then you have to wait. So it'd rather be early than late. Ruben, what I used to do is give them fake dates a week before. So then, you know, when it comes in terms of
credit. Communicating with them at all. We have to submit by the 10th, I'll need it by the 7th.
Yeah. So you can check and look for corrections, whatever, and give it in. Because when it goes on that day to a work study, and work study finds an error, and they can't get hold of you, then they're not going to process it for that month, and then you have to wait. Okay? Class size, we usually say between 30, maximum 30, 20, 25-30, but some faculties have been going over to 50. But you shouldn't be taking over the whole class at one time and calling that a tutorial. It's not a tutorial. It's small group sizes. And your work hours, Ruben, you would have went over work hours with them?
Yeah, I've indicated to them exactly undergrads that's only allowed to work for 10 hours and then the 60 and 80 for the
And then what is compulsory is attendance for tutor training and then follow-up support workshops that we have. Okay, what a tutor is not responsible for, and this is important. So if Ruben or anybody else asks you to do it, tell him no, you're not responsible for this. Firstly, having all the answers. Okay, you're not supposed to have all the answers. Nobody would have all the answers. So feel comfortable in that, because sometimes students get really nervous when they get into a class and they say, just in case they ask me a question and I don't know the answer, what should I do? So you can even tell them up front, I may not know all the answers, but I can help you to find your way and find those answers. So you shouldn't be worried about that. Then being a lecturer in the tutorial, you shouldn't be doing that. You shouldn't be going to that once a week lecture and then coming back and then imitating the lecturer in your tutorial. You are not the lecturer. You're the facilitator, like you guys mentioned, the demonstrator, guiding, helping your students. You shouldn't be replacing your lecturer in the lecture room. Your lecturer is going for a conference, going for a workshop, going on sabbatical and say, please can you just teach this class for me? Not that. If he's willing or she's willing to give you that salary for that replacement lecture, there. No, I'm joking. Not at all. They can pay you for that lecture. Okay? So you're not the lecturer. You have a special role and you shouldn't be doing the lecture as well. You are not an examiner. You shouldn't be setting exam papers. You shouldn't be setting test papers. You're not trained to be, well, you guys are because you're faculty of education students, but you're not trained to be setting higher education exam papers or marking their tests and exams for them. If you do marking, it's marking of your tutorial. Whatever tutorial task you give him, you mark that. So if your lecturer comes up to you and say, you know, my students wrote a test, can you please assist and mark this for me? Ruben will see to
it. I mentioned it last week as well. So that we know that we're not going to be spoiling, we're not going to be held accountable for something that you are not supposed to be doing.
Yes, because you can get into big trouble. Being a PA for your lecturer. Okay, you shouldn't be doing your PA or your lecturer's work, uploading his marks or her marks, cleaning her office or his office, doing the photocopying for your lecturer. Yes,
but that's the problem with the coordinating and all of those things.
And it involves certain techniques and skills that you do every week during engineering art, then this will go you with your personality. You don't kind of expect anything too big or too much. Like you're just offering a service. It's not
beyond
it.
Yes, you're supporting your students. Your main aim is for your students to become independent learners and to be socially and academically integrated into the university environment. So your task is to make sure they cope with the academic work and they don't drop out and they don't fail. And it's specifically for your subject that you tutoring, not for the whole course, because it's not your responsibility.
Well, just because I want to say, I had an experienced tutor who was an excellent tutor, but he was like, he was helpful, he was available a lot of full time of the hours he was available to help with your writing, to help with, like, he introduced me to Noam Chomsky's videos, and that, like, really, so it was like extracurricular, and he was coming in on Saturdays to help people with your writing and things like that. Is that good? Is that acceptable as a tutor?
I'm going to, and just to revisit what we spoke about last week, you need to have those boundaries. It's always good and well if you go and you want to assist, but at the end of the day, the students can have the sense of entitlement that you must, and then also because you're doing it and they say they're interested, because she's got boundaries, you need to just be very careful that you don't overstep that. I said last week, set yourself a time. 5 o'clock, you don't answer any emails, because remember, you also have your studies to focus on. And you can become so engulfed with other people's problems that you might suffer. And that is why I'd like to go with what Bonita said. You need to also put yourself there and say, I also need to tend to my situation. So I'm not shooting that tutor down, but don't try to emulate that person to your own detriment. It doesn't mean that you need to be available 24/7. They need to respect your time. I've said to you guys, I will send you an email at 10 o'clock in the evening, but I'm not expecting you to respond. You as a tutor can respond tomorrow morning. It's just that I've got the time to send it out at that point in time. Something that came up. But just make sure that you've got the parameters. I used the example last week when I said, Robert Frost says, good pencils make for good neighbors. Mm-hmm. And therefore you need to tell them, this is the time that I'm available. I've got consultation, but I also have a private life, a personal life, and I need to also teach you my studies. And that is only my word of caution to you, and I know I am repeating what I said last week. But sometimes we end up becoming so involved, you want to help them so much, because you take ownership, but you need to also know the boundaries. I hope that does answer your question.
Yeah.